Good morning, everyone. So I'm Hideaki Itsuno from Capcom, director for Dragon's Dogma. Today I'll be taking you behind the scenes of Dragon's Dogma. I started my career at Capcom in 1994, and since I've worked on several titles, just to name a few, Street Fighter Alpha, Star Gladiator, Rival School Series, Capcom vs. SNK Series, Power Stone, Devil May Cry Series, as well as Dragon's Dogma. The most recent one, you may know, is Devil May Cry 4. So again, I'll be taking you behind the scenes of Dragon's Dogma today. Although the game was released last year, the project started about 5 years ago. So from a technical standpoint, some information you may find might be a little old. It was around May 2008, just a few months after we shipped Devil May Cry. It had been a while since I worked on a new IP. Well, about 12 years to be exact, since the Rival School series. And it seemed like the right time to challenge something new. The mission I was given was a new IP that was capable of moving X number of units worldwide. On the slide you see here, I'm not disclosing the number on the slide here, but it was 1 million units. So I ended up presenting about 5 different kinds of concepts. The first one was an all-new fighting game. I get too excited thinking about this idea, so I'm going to keep it at that for now. Hopefully, I can talk about this later, sometime in the future. The second one was a 3D action fighting game. We were very proud of what we achieved in Devil May Cry. So, in particular, the fights between Dante and Nero. So I wanted to take that element to the next level. The third one was an action RPG, where action would replace the turn-based or menu-based command seen in the traditional RPGs. At least in Japan, Dragon's Dogma would fall into this category. The fourth idea was more of a traditional RPG with menu-based commands, similar to Final Fantasy or Dragon Quest. The fifth idea was a sim, actually. I'm a huge fan of sandbox-style sim games like SimCity and A-Train, so I thought of challenging that genre. I'm very into SimCity right now. The sixth was an adventure game, where you would encounter and experience an incident set in an enclosed space, such as a ship or express rail train, plane, or a structure with in and outs. For this, my goal was to create a very deep, thorough experience in a very confined space. So if I could, I would work on all these. But I already have cool ideas for them, so maybe sometime in the future. So after pitching all these concepts, the target sales number quickly changed. Of course, the number grew larger to 2 million, 3 million, 4 million copies globally. And I'm sure if we have any people who've been involved in those kind of conversations, you know what that means. So going back to around the year 2000, right around when we were finishing up Capcom versus SNK 2, I had a chance to launch a new IP and started drafting a concept document for a new RPG. And I was very serious and invested a fair amount of time in researching the world's ruins as well as creatures and monsters. As I was planning for this next game, my former boss at that time asked, or rather ordered, to come help out the DMC2 project. That ended up becoming a longer assignment than originally planned, and as a result, I ended up working on DMC for about 7 years and putting the RPG project on hold during that time. I mean, technically speaking, I was working on DMC, the latest one, up until recently. The idea of pawns, which is one of the core elements of Dragon's Dogma, was born around this time. This key concept of pawns, where it comes from, is that it comes from bulletin board systems, or I'm going to say BBS for short, or forums that we're used to today. The casualness and the ease of use and a synchronous format allow for users to communicate without worrying about any time restrictions, but it was just as effective as communicating via live text or video chat. That's where this idea all started. We wanted to bring that casualness, that element, into the game. Oh, and by the way, some of the concept artwork you'll see in these slides today are never-before-seen assets from Dragon's Dogma. And not even maybe included in some of our art books. And these were done by Itsuno-san, known best for his work in Street Fighter IV. So prior to joining the Devil May Cry 2 team as a supporter, I was working on this concept. So I had what I believe was a very, very strong concept, but I struggled when I tried to explain this to others. They didn't really get it right away. Now that the game is out, it's very easy to point to it and say, hey, that's what I was talking about. But when there's nothing like it out there, it's very difficult to get your ideas across. I'm sure everyone has experienced that before. And please think about it was around spring of 2008. Not many action-oriented RPGs were around. This was also before Dark Souls. And smartphones weren't everyone's devices, so we weren't used to social games either. We all know what an open-world game is today, but the concept was still fairly new and hadn't reached the mainstream level. And not everyone understood what to expect. Especially in Japan, open-world games were few and far between, so it was difficult to explain to others. The concept of lending and borrowing pawns just wasn't getting through. They didn't understand why and what part of this was supposed to be fun. So to be honest, they didn't fully get it until the very, very end. Our own development team members finally got it when they connected online, and our staff members from other Capcom teams told me they finally understood it when they played the retail version of the game. So the concept was coming together in this manner. First, the communication aspect. Through the pawn system, you will communicate with many other players in the world. Second, to create an RPG using the principles and method we use making action games. And then third, an open world game. The concept art you see in the bottom right corner here is an early pass of the main character. His hair is very similar to Dante, don't you think? In Japan, silver or whitish color hair is seen as cool, so they are likely to become lead characters. But I've seen so many opinions on the boards from overseas players that that's a hair color for lunatics. Here I'm going to show you the concept document I use internally to present this project. These documents are rarely shown to people outside of our group, not just because they contain confidential information, but because a lot of our games didn't follow the original concept, and we're sort of embarrassed to share them. I'm half joking, but for Dragon's Dogma, the final product mirrors the original concept we envisioned for the game. So I'm not ashamed or embarrassed to show this to you today. In the early days of development, we gave Dragon's Dogma the code name BBS-RPG, or CMC Online. As I mentioned earlier, BBS is the bulletin board system, or forum, and CMC stood for Custom Mercenary Character. That's the word we use until we formally decided to go with pawn. The main focus of the document was on this new pawn system. So, what is a BBS RPG? Well, I'm sure you feel the same way, hopefully, but, you know, online bulletin boards and forums are fun to read, but actively posting on them is 100% more enjoyable. Just merely getting a response to something that you wrote by someone who's reading it is very much enjoyable. It's fun. And then CMCs, Custom Mercenary Character, which we rename to Pawn. They can be lent out to other players, our AI-controlled NPCs, that can learn. And on to the overview of the game. Game is an action RPG based on a four-member party system. The player, you, control one party member, and the other three are the CMCs. And then the game allows, it's played offline, but communicates with the server at the start and end of play. And this allows for zero lag, which means absolute precision and controls. So then who forms the four-man party? As shown here, we had originally planned for non-human characters, like pets, sort of like Pikachu. And, you know, part human and part non-human to become pawns. The idea was to have a nice variety in your party, from pet and cute characters to maybe even partners or girlfriends. Or even a yojimbo. So here's a little bit more about the CMCs. The player's CMC is their sole partner. The player can customize the appearance and the abilities of their CMC. The quests are carried out by a four-member party. Again, one player and three CMCs. The action is very intense, and the player can't do everything alone. So you're able to build a strategy that best fits your playstyle, depending on if you want to go all-out action or maybe skew a little bit heavily on the RPG aspect of the game. And then let me explain a little bit about how the network component worked or how we envisioned it. You can borrow the CMCs and play with them. While it's possible to party up with the NPCs made by the developer, you can also download others' CMCs and embark on quests with them. In other words, every CMC created by players from all over the world would be uploaded to our server and available to select, download, and bring on an adventure. And then send your own CMC on adventures with players from around the world. When this happens, the next time you play with your CMC, besides bringing back items, they will have picked up information from other players, as well as new behaviors and habits. So by playing with other players, your CMC can deliver information that you wouldn't have otherwise known. So my job was to try to convince the internal members of the company that this is a challenge that I want to take on. So similar genres in this open world, similar games in this open world RPG genre didn't really exist in Japan. So we were unable to accurately forecast how well the title would sell or the market potential. At the very least, I listed some examples of titles in the West that you're all familiar with and try to explain that potential. However, aside from the various development teams at Capcom, even the name Oblivion was new to a lot. It was almost unheard of. So even after this, I would have to break it down and explain how these games were different from these so-called JRPGs or something like Dragon Quest and Final Fantasy. So as you can see in the bottom, I'm putting an emphasis on the word action rather than emphasis on the word RPG. So that was our goal. With regards to game difficulty, we wanted to give the player the option to strategize depending on their playstyle, as I said earlier. So with the use of CMCs, you're able to balance the play, and we were hoping that that would open it up to a broader user base. watched. With these goals in mind, we thought we were ready to embark on this project, but we still had several technical challenges to overcome. First is the character editor. At Capcom, we didn't have the tech that supported this level of flexibility for character customization. The communication that was taking place amongst players via the pawn system was important, but equally important was how they looked on the outside. So as you can see from left to right here in this image, we had various body types, and we needed a practical solution where we could use the same motion data across all types. Specifically, we were envisioning an action-driven game where these characters would have weapons, and some would require maybe both hands. So even if the arms and legs were individually swapped out, the hands holding the weapons needed to remain in its position. Second was the online aspect of the game. From the beginning, our goal was to figure out a way to utilize the leaderboards on both the 360 and the PS3 consoles without having to set up our own servers. So that would mean $0 or 0 yen in operation and maintenance for us. It took us a very, very long time to come up with this, but we made it happen. We're using the small space allowed where you can upload screens and video. Instead, you can leave messages for the owner of the pawn. For Xbox 360 users, we did away with the matching. As we wanted to encourage many users to play and lower the bar of entry to at least the silver level members. We tested this as well. And third, seamless stage transitions. At Capcom, this was our first attempt to make a game without loading stages and instead aiming for seamless transitions in between stages. I'm going to show you a video we created and used for our internal presentation. This was the result of these experiments and the testing that we did for the character editor. You'll not only see the various body types and faces, but also the application of the same motion data across them as well as male and female models.
アクションRPGを作ることを目標としています。その中でも、ユーザーの自由度を優先したキャラクターエディットは重要なファクターです。しかし、ある壁が立ち塞がりました。自由度の高いキャラクターエディットを実現すればするほど、アニメーターの作業量が増大していくという事例まで。そして、3ヶ月の研究の結果、
ついに実現しました。柔道高いフェイシャルエディットとアニメーションデータの流用を可能にした新しいシステムを、目の大きさ、位置の変更など、細かい調整はもちろん、太る、痩せる、歯を伸ばす、子供っぽい顔にする、 など、事細かな調整をしながらも、フェイシャルアニメーションの使い回しを可能にしたのです。さて、キャラクターメイクに必要なものは、顔のカスタマイズだけではありません。当然、体型の変形も必要です。筋肉質から、
飛び飛ぶ取った村人など体型も変形させながらモーションの使い回しを可能にしました。手足の長さも自由に変更でき、なおかつ手の位置取り、足の滑りという問題は起こっていません。また個性にはセンサーというものも必要でしょう。男っぽく歩いたり、女性らしい歩き、同一モーションにセンサーを感じさせるようなプログラムも開発しました。顔、体を自由にカスタマイズさせつつ、アニメーターの作業軽減を実現するシステム、それがついに実現したのです。さらにそのシステムは人型であればモンスターにも適用可能です。全く同じモーションを使いつつ体型変化させていることにご注目ください。
聞かせてさあ冒険してみない楽しいこと始めよう飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい飛びたい
内容のプレゼン映像なんですけども、踊りの方ばっかり見てしまうんですけど、手をこういう風に。
So again, this was an internal presentation video that we made 5 years ago. And the dance portion that you saw towards the end, it's not really the dance movements, but it's where the hands come together for the various sized monsters. Those were the little things that we focused on. So using this new technology, we were able to apply the same motion data to nearly all the human NPC characters, as well as the monsters. And it resulted in our team completing the motion production work in 1/3 of the normal workload. Now, I'd like to show you another video. This was created for the internal greenlight meeting to officially kick off the project and has never been shared with anyone outside our company. You can only communicate so much in a concept or design document, especially when trying to demonstrate a new type of game, launch a new IP, or explaining new systems. So I'm sure you have done the same and created a video to show exactly what you're trying to do, although I don't know how often you've shared it with the outside world. So that video was created about a year and a half before the game was released. And if you played the game, you probably have noticed that some parts of the video were pretty close to what was in the final product. This is nothing we don't know, nothing new that we don't know, but creating a new IP isn't that easy. And I hope you all agree. Or maybe that's just in Japan, or maybe that's just a Capcom thing. So I'm going to highlight a few areas where we really struggled. And please know that our team, including my own self, we had never developed an RPG or an open world game. So everything was a first for us, which meant a lot of trial and error. Obviously, the new genre, open world RPG, new challenges. And then creating more freedom without creating more work. As you just saw in the demo. In other words, how can we be more efficient? And then redrawing the map. I'll show you a few examples after this slide, but an island became a peninsula. So this comes from the first concept document, the complete world map. As you can see, it was originally an island and not a peninsula. If you play the game, you'll notice that there are more than twice as many locations on this map compared to the final product. And some of you may also notice that the color coding is very similar to something like you see in Dragon Quest. The various areas are unlocked by level progression. For example, if we had set the max game beating level as 100, you can see how we mapped out the locations as the player advanced in the game. There were also stages that didn't make the final cut, you see here on the left, such as the moon and the endless tower. Although this is an open-world game, the various stages in the map will open up as you progress further in the game. So on the left here, I'm showing the quest that we assume is taking place on this route. So in this case, the Cyclops battle and the repairing of the bridge happening around the same time. And then on to the summoning. And finally, you reach the location of the dragon's crest, which is needed to enter the ruins on the top left. And so it continued. Here we have the conceptual diagram of the world in Dragon's Dogma. So conceptually, it's a world of parallel worlds, stacked endlessly above and below each other. The green map is a single-player's game or world, and each of these parallel worlds are being played locally. Only the pawns are able to cross over between the parallel worlds through a gate we call Rim, and the only point or connection between the worlds is the endless tower that's going down the center of this diagram here. And that's shared in real time between all the worlds. In the final product, instead of the tower, it's a ruin called Everfall. It was very difficult to explain this world and setting, so this was my attempt to communicate how this all worked. So here are all the subquests. The notes contained on the side, they contain information about the subquests and the events in the various towns and dungeons. We had an idea to use a hand glider or a hand glider-like kite type thing to sail through the sky and travel to the faraway island. So even though we felt like we had a good thing going, the thing is, it was as the game was about twice as large as the final product. There was no way to create this game within the budget. So here's a flow chart for the story for from early stages of development. Although the story may appear to have a lot of freedom and flexibility, the truth is that there's one main story and several side stories. In the center, the boxes in red is the main storyline, which you must clear in order to advance in the game. To the left in the orange large box are events that can happen at any given time, not restricted to a timeline. There's a lot of relationship building type events in that box. And the events and the side quests in the blue box can happen in the same time frame as the main story as you advance. In order to hook the player into thinking that the story is endless, we provide multiple options to choose from, which are all taking place in the same timeline. Another thing we did was to have the outcome of one quest affect another, and vice versa. Instead of gathering a bunch of short stories or episodes and making it into one large story, we told multiple stories in the same timeline, which created an illusion that it was a fairly large story and also lessened the overall workload for us. But even then, the game was still roughly 1.3 times larger than the final product. We got it down, but we needed to maybe do a little bit more work. The background image you see here is one of my favorites, so I included it in this slide today. In the end, we somehow managed to ship the game. And I brought one more thing to share today. It's the announcement trailer we were planning to debut at Tokyo Game Show in 2010. Instead, we ended up announcing Devil May Cry 4 at the event, and maybe some of you may remember that, and hopefully play the game too. But we were preparing to announce both games at the same time. I had the director who directed and edited the trailers for both DMC 3 and 4 working on Dragon's Dogma. That would be Yuji Shimomura. In the end, the announcement was put off, so we didn't have a chance to complete the trailer, but here it is.
ありがとうございます。
Thank you very much. As you saw, the dragon was still showing in silhouette form. The texture wasn't done at that time, so as a last-ditch measure, we had no choice but to show a silhouette against the lighting. In addition, large monsters were supposed to be one of the cool things, but we ended up with only a cyclops, and other monster designs that lacked impact were shelved. That was one of the reasons why we had to push back the announcement. And looking at the designs today, I can completely understand why these didn't work. So here's a quick look at the hairstyles. We initially had maybe prepared about 40 or so, but we were getting some requests for additional ones, so we came up with a lot, as you can see. And then we also conducted a survey, both in Japan and in overseas, to make the final selections. Just, by the way, this has nothing to do with the monster and the size chart in the background. So the game has been out for some time now, and we've sold over 1 million units worldwide. Fans are asking for a sequel, and a lot of players are still doing multiple playthroughs. And by the way, if you've been following, you may probably know this, but the Dark Arisen expansion pack is coming very soon. Here are just some examples of the title logo that we were working with. And that's it. Thank you.
できるだけ質問に答えたいと思いますので、お願いします。
So we're going to open it up for Q&A. We have maybe about 10 minutes, and there are two microphones. So if anyone has any questions, please walk up to the mic and ask Itsuno-san your question.
Many open world games, there's a lot of collectible systems and things like that. Did you, design them with your BBS system in mind, or was it a separate design?
はい、BBS のシステムと、コレクタブルアイテムのをたくさんいるようなオープンワールドのシステムを別々に考えたかどうかという質問でしたが、まずは BBS をの楽しみっていうのを持っていくことを主眼に考えました、その後いかにこのオープンワールドを楽しませる、要するにユーザーに、時間をかけて飽きない作りにするかっていうところは後付けで、足していった感じになります。
So, it was separate. The BBS system, definitely came first. We wanted to see how much of the fun, the enjoyment, as I said earlier in my presentation, how much of that we can bring into the game. So that was core, and it came first. And then after, in order to have the players enjoy, you know, the game in a more full way, what other things can we add and to keep them going, keep them motivated? So that came later.
Hajimashite. As much as I hate to say this, I loved almost all of Dragon's Dogma, but I actually did not like the pawn system. The problem I had was that because you had two characters that never stayed with you and never grew with you, I did not make that connection to them. They almost felt like a piece of armor or a weapon that I would throw away and get a new one with. When you listen to the fan feedback after the game's been released, do you feel like players out there really understood what you wanted to do with the pawn system? Or do you feel like there might have been some sort of disconnect for some players that you could think about improving in the next version of the game?